بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
A presentation of Quran Sunnah educational programs. Visit us online at www.qsep.com.
إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء ومن يشرك بالله فقد افترى إثما عظيما.
الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
Explaining توحيد and shirk.
Just like توحيد is three types: توحيد الربوبية, توحيد الأسماء والصفات, توحيد الألوهية العبادة. Shirk is also can be in ربوبية, can be in أسماء والصفات, can be in ألوهية عبادة. توحيد الربوبية means to believe that Allah سبحانه وتعالى is the only creator, the only provider, the only sustainer, the only ruler, the only master, the only king. This is the meaning of توحيد الربوبية. The Arabs say الرب, السيد, the master, or المالك, الملك, the owner, the king. So those are the constituents of توحيد الربوبية. And the Arabs used to believe in this. The idol worshippers used to believe in this. Allah has mentioned this in his book. And we will show this when we speak about the four principles of shirk. And regarding the توحيد of names of Allah and attributes, the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah is to believe in all what Allah has said about himself in his book. Any attribute that he attributes to himself, our duty is to accept it as it is, because no one knows Allah better than himself. And because that's how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. It is not known in any hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam changed any meaning of any attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would describe Allah with any description, there is not even a weak hadith where it says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the people, don't understand this attribute literally, but take it as such and such. There is nothing like that. Not even a weak hadith. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah challenged the Ash'ari scholars in the presence of the Ash'ari Sultan in their time. He challenged them. He said, I will give you 3 years to bring me one single narration, even if it's weak. By weak, he means not something which is made up or something which is very weak. No. يعني, it has some kind of criticism in the narration. And they couldn't take the challenge. And they finished that session agreeing with Shaykh al-Islam that what he says is the right thing and is the way of Ahl Sunnah, because he brought them all the proofs from Quran and Sunnah and from the statements of the four Imams, rahimahumullah. So this is the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, is to have faith in all the names and attributes of Allah, not just some attributes like the Ash'aris and Maturidis do nowadays. When we speak about the Ash'aris, we are speaking about Al-Azhar in Egypt, we are speaking about Africa, about Malaysia, about يعني, some parts in the Indian continent, but the Indian continent is mostly Maturidis. They follow Abu Mansur al-Maturidi, a Hanafi scholar, who came after Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, by at least 200 years, at least after the death of Imam Abu Hanifa by at least 200 years. And the Maturidis and the Ash'aris agree on the principles regarding the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they differ in very minor things, but they agree on the attribute, on the principles regarding the attributes of Allah. They don't approve most of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as they are. And then we come to the third aspect of Tawheed, and that is the goal of all Tawheed, and that is the message of all the messengers, and that is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, to unify Allah in worship, to make all the worship for Allah alone. That's why it is called Tawheed al-Ibadah. Tawheed al-Ibadah is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, as Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma when he explained the name Allah. He said, "Dhul ubudiyyati wal uluhiyya ala khalqihi ajma'in." So he explained Allah in this context, that he is the one who deserves to be worshipped by his creatures. And this kind of tawheed was the issue of all nations between them and their prophets. That's why in Quran you find the description, Allah says about every prophet that he started his da'wah with this. Ya qawmi ubudu Allah ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. My people, oh my people, worship Allah, for you have no God but Him. No one worthy of being worshipped but Him. So this is the third kind of tawheed. And the shirk that was at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in worship, but it was on a much lower level than the shirk of the grave worshippers nowadays. And you will see how this is, inshallah, when we speak about the four principles, that the shirk of Abu Jahl was much less than the shirk of the grave worshippers nowadays, who say by their tongue, La ilaha illallah, which shows how ignorant they are about La ilaha illallah. Because Abu Jahl was committing little shirk compared to them, even though it was great shirk. It took him out of Islam. He was called a mushrik. But it was little in quantity, not in quality. In quality, it was great shirk. But in quantity, if you compare Abu Jahl's shirk to the shirk of the grave worshippers nowadays, you will see how little it is. And despite that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to threaten Abu Jahl and his like. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was giving a speech once, Abu Jahl and some of the mushriks were hearing, and they were saying something, showing their protest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or their dislike. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam threatened them. He said, "Jئتكم بالذبح." I have come to you with this, with slaughter. And this was a special speech for Abu Jahl and some other mushriks with him. Because right after this threat, the Battle of Badr occurred, and Abu Jahl and those people, the same people that the Prophet ﷺ told them, جئتكم بالذبح, they were killed in the Battle of Badr. يعني it occurred so soon. يعني the threat, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this is going to be their fate. Don't worry about them. So, this is regarding the three types of tawheed, and the shirk can be in either part. The great shirk can be either in lordship, which is the shirk of the grave worshippers nowadays, and can be in names and attributes. It can be either by resembling Allah's attributes to the creature's attributes. Also, the shirk in worship is to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either by supplication or by dua or by sacrifice or by going around the graves or whatever type of shirk, or by the inner actions of the heart, the trust and the fear and the love and those actions of the heart. Actually, no one will fall in the actions of the limbs that are shirk before he falls in his heart in shirk, because this is the basis for your limbs' actions. The heart is the basis, you see. So, therefore, anyone who commits actions of shirk, either by supplicating or by going around the grave or by seeking blessings from the grave or whatever kind, that's because the shirk is in his heart. You see, he has established the shirk in the heart before it happened on his limbs.
Is the Muslim Ummah protected from shirk? The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, "By Allah, I am not afraid that you will worship others along with Allah after my death, but I am afraid that you will fight one another for the worldly things." Does this hadith indicate that the Muslim Ummah is protected from shirk?
This is not the far future that the Prophet ﷺ is speaking about. He was speaking about the near future. This is the same as another hadith which is misunderstood and used by the grave worshippers, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna ash-shaytana an ya'isa, inna ash-shaytana ya'isa an ya'budahu al-musallun fi jazirat al-Arab, walakin bit-tahrish baynahum." That shaytan has become desperate from hoping that you will worship other than Allah. But he is not desperate of making disputes amongst you. This is the same thing. This is for the near future. This was for the companions. Their faith was very strong. Their tawheed was very strong. So the Prophet ﷺ gave them this news that you will not fall into shirk. And they didn't fall into shirk. As a matter of fact, no companion has fallen into an innovation, let alone a shirk. This shows how strong they were, you see. And this is natural because their instructor was who? He was the greatest instructor. The messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see. Unlike what the kafirs claim, that as soon as the Prophet died, all the companions became mushriks and kafirs, you see. How could you say this? This is a big slander to the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What kind of education, what kind of educator is this man? If as soon as he dies, all his followers, except one or two or three, will be kafirs again. What kind of nonsense is this? Who believes this but a donkey? Huh? No one believes such a thing. Even Jews cannot believe this. There is no Jew who claims that the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of them except three or four, turned away from Islam after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I challenge to bring me one quotation by any Jew or Christian who says this. No. You will not find any of this. But you find it by those kafirs who claim it nowadays. So those hadiths are used by the grave worshippers nowadays to protect themselves. You see, when you tell them what you're doing is shirk, they don't want to hear it. They say, you are saying what the Prophet said opposite to it. The Prophet said the shirk will not come back in this nation. We say, no, That's not what the Prophet said. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was speaking to the companions radiyallahu anhu. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in other true hadiths, he said that the hour would not come until groups of my nation will go back to idol worship. لا تقوم الساعة حتى تعود فئام من أمتي إلى عبادة الأوثان. لا تقوم الساعة حتى تعود فئام من أمتي إلى عبادة اللات والعزى. This is as clear as the sun, and it's a true hadith. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith is stating it clearly that the hour would not come until groups of my nation go back to shirk, go back to idol worship. Idol worshiping doesn't just mean to make an idol of stone and worship it. No. Even following the man-made law is idol worshiping. If you make it a substitute for Allah's law, then this is an idol. This is a taghut, as Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab mentioned when he mentioned the five heads of tawaghit, you see. To accept the man-made law instead of the rule of Allah, this is worshipping the taghut, and this is idol worshipping. Whether you like it or not, whether you know it or not, that's something else. You see, Umar radiallahu anhu said, إِنَّمَا تُنْقَضُ عُرَى الْإِسْلَامِ عُرْوَةٌ عُرْوَةٌ إِذَا نَشَأَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ مَنْ لَا يَعْرِفِ الْجَاهِلِيَةِ. That the ties of Islam will be broken one by one when there will be people who will become ignorant of Islam and ignorant of Jahiliyyah. They will fall into the same thing that the people of Jahiliyyah fall into, because they are ignorant of them. They don't know it's from Jahiliyyah. So this is regarding this question, inshallah. The innovators say that the first obligation on everyone is to look around so that he is guided to the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not an obligation, let alone that it becomes the first obligation. No nation has been known to deny the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No nation has been known to deny the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah is the creator, the provider. No nation. No prophet came to his people to guide them to rububiyyah or to the existence of Allah. No. They were all accepting that. And now if you make, if you ask people in America, for example, you will find more than 95-98% say we believe in God. Okay. So to say that the first obligation is to look, this is nonsense, has no basis in Quran and Sunnah. True, Quran encourages you to look into Allah's creation, because this will increase your faith, not because this will bring you your faith. No, your faith is from the Book of Allah and from the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Plus, you are born as natural believer in Allah. If nothing changes this nature in you, it will remain there. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma min mauludin illa wa yuladu ala al-fitra." Every newborn is born on this implanted faith in Allah, in Tawheed, in Him, in Islam. So then, فَأَبَوَاهُ يُهَوِّدَانِهِ أَوْ يُمَجِّسَانِهِ. His fathers, his parents, will cause his deviation from Tawheed, you see, either to Christianity or to Judaism or to Hinduism or to Buddhism or what, grave worshipping, same thing. So the first duty here, they say, is to look. And some of them say to intend to look. And some of them say, no, you should first doubt, then go and look. Or then go and intend to look, then go and look. What is this garbage? Yani, this has no base in Islam, you see. You are believing in Allah. You go and doubt deliberately. What guarantees you that you will come to faith? Subhanallah. So this is something that is yani, completely false. So tawheed, meaning to worship Allah alone, this is the only gate to Islam. Not looking or intending to look or this or that. No, tawheed, meaning worshipping Allah. This is the gate to Islam. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And this is the thing that if someone leaves this life with, he will be a Muslim. Otherwise, no. If he loses it before death, he lost Islam. He lost everything.
First foundation. The disbelievers whom the messenger fought affirmed that Allah is the creator and disposer of all affairs, yet their affirmation did not enter them into Islam.
Verses in Quran are very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you were to ask them, the idol worshippers, who is the Lord of the heavens and of the earth, they would say Allah. Who is the one in control of the affairs? They would say Allah. Who is the Lord of the great throne? They would say Allah. Who is the one who provides you with provision and rain and this? They would say Allah. This is clear in Quran, many verses. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this, he didn't say that the idol worshippers are saying something, but they are actually not believing in it. No, they were believing in it. That's why Allah did not deny that what they were saying is false, because Allah knows what's in their hearts. They were believing that Allah is the only creator, Allah is the only Lord, Allah is the only master, Allah is the only ruler. They knew all that. When in their tawaf, they were making tawaf around the idols and around the Kaaba, they would say, لبيك اللهم لبيك. Oh, our Lord, we answer your call. We answer your call. لَبَّيْكَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ. Oh, Allah, we answer your call, for there is no companion with you, meaning in lordship. Because after that, they said, إِلَّا شَرِيكًا. Except one companion that is in worship. So you have no companion in lordship, but you have a companion in worship. And they thought that's okay. They thought that to have a companion in lordship is shirk, and great shirk, and kufr. But to have a companion in worship, it's not shirk. That's why they said, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. That we don't worship them except to bring us closer to Allah. So they thought this does not reach the level of great kufr and shirk. But Allah told them, قُلْ لِلَّهِ الشَّفَاعَةُ جَمِيعًا. This is the position of Allah only. You cannot make your own aspects in Tawheed. You cannot say, we have this much and we consider it Tawheed and not Shirk. It's Allah who decides. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ لِلَّهِ الشَّفَاعَةُ جَمِيعًا. So how could you say, we only worship them because we think they will bring us closer to Allah, or because they are our shufa'a. This is very clear in Quran. And the Arabs used to, as I said, when they used to go around the grave, they said, لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك إلا شريكا هو لك تملكه وما ملك. That this associate in worship has nothing in lordship. He owns nothing. You own him and you own everything that he owns. تملكه وما ملك. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the beginning of his da'wah, he used to go with them in the tawaf and he used to tell them when they say لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would say قط قط, stop, stop there, that's it, that's enough, don't add more, because what they are going to add is the great shirk. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was giving them da'wah in this way. This is what Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did in the beginning of his da'wah also. He used to go with them around the grave of Zayd ibn al-Khattab and he would say, Allahu khayrun min Zayd. Allahu khayrun min Zayd. Allahu khayrun min Zayd. When they used to supplicate to Zayd, he used to say, Allah is better than Zayd. Allah is better than Zayd. Allah is better than Zayd. Why? Because in this time, if he tells them, no, this is shirk, they will break him like this, like a fish. They will break him into pieces and throw him out. But he wanted to give them da'wah. So he started in a gentle way so that they give him a chance to give them da'wah. That's okay. Now, Tawheed al-Uluhiyya includes Tawheed al-Rububiyya. The Arabic word is يتضمن. Includes Tawheed al-Rububiyya. Which means what? Which means that if you have established Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, then that automatically means you have established Tawheed al-Rububiyya. Yani, why are you worshipping Allah alone? Because you believe that there is no Lord besides Allah. No master, no provider, you see. This there is no way out of this. Yani, no one can worship Allah alone if he has any shirk in rububiyyah. So this is the first relation, tadammun. Tawheed al-uluhiyyah includes tawheed al-rububiyyah. But not the opposite. Tawheed al-rububiyyah does not include tawheed al-uluhiyyah. The Arabs had tawheed al-rububiyyah, but they did not have tawheed al-uluhiyyah, you see. So the relationship between tawheed al-rububiyyah and tawheed al-uluhiyyah is that tawheed al-rububiyyah necessitates tawheed al-uluhiyyah. If you have the faith that Allah is the only Lord, then it is necessary that you should worship Him alone. It is a must. It is an obligation. You say, Allah is the only Lord. Why are you worshipping others besides Him? That simple, you see. So, Tawheed al-Uluhiyya includes Tawheed al-Rububiyya, but not the opposite. But Tawheed al-Rububiyya necessitates Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. That's the relationship.
Is there a proof of such a division before Sheikh Islam Netanyahu?
Oh, before the father and grandfather of Sheikh Islam Netanyahu. They were all scholars, by the way. They have one book called Al-Musawwada by Sheikh Islam Netanyahu and his father and his grandfather. His grandmother, Taymiyyah, was a scholar also. And he is named after her, Taymiyyah. Taymiyyah is the grandmother of Ahmed ibn Abdul Halim ibn Abdul Salam ibn Taymiyyah al-Harrani rahimahullah. The Abdullah ibn Abbas, as I mentioned earlier about him, when he explained the word Allah, the name Allah, he said, ذو الألوهية والعبودية على خلقه أجمعين. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he sent Mu'adh to Yemen, he said, let the first thing that you call them to be is La ilaha illallah. And in another narration, he explained it. He said that the first thing that you call them to be ila an ya'budu Allah wahda, that they worship Allah alone. So ilah means the one who deserves worship. You see? Also in the verse where it says, مَا يُؤْمِنُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ, that those have faith in Allah and yet they have shirk, was explained by Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said, يُؤْمِنُونَ بِأَنَّهُ خَالِقُهُمْ وَرَازِقُهُمْ وَيُشْرِكُونَ مَعَهُ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ. So here, Ibn Abbas is making it clear. He said, مَا يُؤْمِنُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ, that they have faith in Allah's lordship, إِلَّا وَهُمْ يُشْرِكُونَ in his worship. So, lordship and worship. And also, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his first order in Quran, يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم. What does it mean? اعبدوا means ألهوا, because عبادة is إلهة in Arabic. اعبدوا ربكم. ألوهية, ربوبية. Allah knows that the Arabs used to consider him the Rabb, but they did not consider him the Ilah. They consider him the greatest ilah, but not the ilah. So he is ordering them, اعبدوا ربكم. This is the first order in Quran. This is uluhiyya, rububiyya. You see? Also, we showed in Surah Al-Fatiha, الحمد لله رب العالمين, rububiyya, رب العالمين, الرحمن الرحيم, مالك يوم الدين. These are attributes. إياك نعبد. This is uluhiyya, ibadah. Okay. So, also, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This has ism, which here does not mean one name. No, it means all the names of Allah. Okay, amongst them, the Rabb, the Malik, Al-Hakim, and so on. So, Bismillah. This includes rububiyyah, names and attributes, and uluhiyya, Allah. And there are many other verses like this in Quran. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa. This is uluhiyya. Al-hayyu al-qayyumu la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm. This is names and attributes. Lahu ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. This is rububiyya. So it's in the first surah and the greatest surah. It's in the greatest ayah, Ayatul Kursi. It's the first order in Quran. It's the first action, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. It is you whom we worship only. So, and it's many other verses in Quran like that. Nah. So, this is clear. And the scholars who wrote about this, early scholars, Ibn Khuzaymah, he wrote At-Tawheed, and he mentioned Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah. Ibn Manda wrote At-Tawheed, and this was all before 300 Hijri. You see? Ibn Khuzaymah, Ibn Manda, and many other scholars in that time, they said Rububiyyah, Uluhiyyah, and some of them said Sifat. Rububiyyah, Uluhiyyah, Sifat. يعني at least 300 years before Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. At least 300 years. يعني one thing just to add regarding this, the innovators, whenever they find themselves empty of proofs, and whenever they find the proofs of Al-Sunnah are as clear as the sun, they resort to this thing. They say, no one said this except those scholars. No one said this but Ibn Taymiyyah. No one said this but Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. No one said this but Saudi scholars. You see? This is a sign of weakness. This is just like giving up, you know? Last night, I was hearing to a singer who calls himself an Islamic singer. I don't know how they come together, yani, but... And he said, when he was speaking about singing and music and all that, he said, No. Outside the Saudi scholars, you find no other scholars make it haram. No other scholars. This is their way, you see. This is how they resort to some silly proof like this, you know, because they are bankrupt. They don't have anything, you see. The best they have is weak hadiths. That's the best they have. That's the best they can come up with. Yeah.
Second foundation. The Mushrikeen said, "We call upon them only to seek nearness and shifa with Allah."
Yeah, that was their only shirk, but it was great shirk. Their shirk was not even denying the oneness of worship for Allah at all times. No. They admitted that in severity, in calamity times, in severity times, that only Allah should be worshipped. Only Allah should be supplicated to. Yani Allah says, if they were to be in a situation where they are drowning, they would say, forget your idols and turn to Allah only. And they will call upon Allah in those situations. Unlike the grave worshippers nowadays, in the most severe conditions, they would not say, "O Allah." In the most severe conditions, they would not say, "Allah." And if they were about to drown, you hear nothing. Yeah, no one says, "O Allah." He is saying, "Oh this," and he is saying, "Oh that." No one says, "Oh Allah." One Salafi scholar was on a ship once. I think he was Siddiq Hasan Khan Qannuji, the Indian scholar from Bahupal. Either him or someone else, Allahu A'lam. He said, we were in such a situation, and I was hearing all the cries and shoutings, "Oh this, oh that, oh this, oh that." He said, I became so angry, I said, "Oh Allah, drown us. Because everyone has forgotten you." Yani, the Arabs, at the time of severity, they would say, "Oh Allah." يدعون الله مخلصين دعوا الله مخلصين له الدين. They would call upon Allah sincerely. So you can see how much great shirk they are falling into. So the Arabs before used to worship Allah, but at the same time worship their idols, because they thought the idols were either angels or pious people. Yani they believed that angels were the daughters of Allah. So they used to make their idols as signs of some angels. And they also make some idols as signs of some pious people, like Al-Lat. Ibn Abbas says, Al-Lat rajulun salih kana yalittu as-sawiqa lil-hujjaj. Al-Lat is a man who was fixing a form of food called sawiq for the pilgrims. And when he died, they started supplicating to him. You see. Also, Ibn Abbas says, Wad wa yaghuth wa ya'uq wa nasr. He says those are the names of pious people in the time of Nuh alayhi salam. When they died, they started worshipping them besides Allah. So this is how those people were doing. This was their shirk. Not more, you see. Not more than this. Nowadays, unfortunately, the grave worshippers don't remember Allah in the most severe cases. They don't call upon the names of the awliya because they want their intercession. Very few who do that. Most of them don't want the intercession. They want them to do the benefit and remove the harm, because they say, since they are walis, then Allah has given them the authority, the power to do whatever they want. They can benefit you in whatever way you want. They can harm you or lift the harm off you. They say they are walis. So that's the meaning of the wali. So wali to them is God. Because no one can lift the harm. No one can benefit you in that way except Allah. You see? And they believe that those walis, their souls after death are free. They are everywhere. They are everywhere. They can see everything. They can hear everything. They can do everything. That's their faith. That's in their books. You see, all the grave worshippers nowadays. I read their book. One book called Ghawthul Ibad by an Egyptian grave worshipper scholar. And this book was introduced by scholars from India, scholars from Egypt, and the biggest, or one of the biggest scholars in Turkey in his time, which is Al-Kawthari. In this book, he says, what's wrong to have a mediator between you and Allah? There is nothing wrong with that. And then he said, what is the meaning of wali? The meaning of wali is that Allah gives them all the power to do all what he wants, to say to this, to something be and it will be. You see? To say to something be and it will be, this is only for Allah. And they claim that this is for the wali. And that the wali has the power to do this and to do everything he wants. After his death, you see, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says clearly in Quran that he holds the soul of the dead with him. Allah says it in Quran, يُمْسِكُ الَّتِي قَضَى عَلَيْهَا بِالْمَوْتِ. He holds it with him. And they say, no, it's free everywhere. It can go wherever it wants. It can hear whatever it wants. It can do whatever it wants. Woe be to those who displease those souls. That's what they say in the book. And we give the glad news for those who please those souls. That's why they please them, by sacrificing the animal, by taking gold to the grave or whatever, by giving oath, whatever it might be, to please them. And what is after pleasing them? It's not that because they want them to be intercessors like Abu Jahl did. No, they go further than Abu Jahl. They want them to do themselves, you see. This is greater shirk than the shirk of Abu Jahl. This is greater shirk because this is shirk in lordship. The fact that they say by Allah's permission, they can hear everything, they can do everything, this doesn't help. This is just like what the Arabs did, and it did not help them. When they used to say, when they're going around the idols, لا شريك لك إلا شريكا هو لك تملكه وما ملك. That those companions in worship, you own them, and you own everything that they own. That didn't make them faithful. The fact that they are saying something true, after the, what they're saying, and that is shirk, doesn't make the shirk become true. Those people claim that the wali will run the affairs of the universe, and they believe that. They believe the Sufis have 47, 44, that they differ. How many walis run the affairs of this world? Some of them say 77 walis. And some of them say 44 walis. Huh? Whether it is 77 or 44, they consider Sajid one of them. That's why they have classified their walis. They say, we have Abdal, we have Autad, we have Aghwath, we have Ghawth al-Aghwath, meaning we have some walis who can run the affairs of villages, you see, and some walis who can run the affairs of whole countries. And some walis can run the affairs of continents. One is for Europe, one is for America, one is for Asia. And some walis can run the affairs of everything. They have the authority to run the affairs of everything. And they differ. Some of them say he is Abdul Qadir. Some of them say, no, Ahmed al-Badawi. Some of them say, no, it is such and such, you see. So this is much greater shirk than the shirk of Abu Jahl. That's why Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Sheikh, the Sheikh of Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, said, those scholars, the imama wearers, he say, Abu Jahl is more knowledgeable about La ilaha illallah than them. And he's right. He's right. Naam. And this book that I mentioned, Ghawth al-Aghwath or Ghawth al-Ibad, was introduced by the biggest scholars, Quburi scholars, on those days. In Egypt, in India, in Turkey, and in other places. They all put their names in the introduction and in the end, approving of all this great shirk.
What is Shafa and its types?
In Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Shafa'ah in two categories of verses. In one category, Allah approves of the Shafa'ah. In another category, Allah denies the Shafa'ah. Therefore, we have two types of Shafa'ah mentioned in Quran. One is the approved Shafa'ah, like what Allah says, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. And we have the denied shafa'ah, لَيْسَ لَهُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مِنْ وَلِيٍّ وَلَا شَفِيعٍ. They don't have a shafi'ah. The approved one is the one for the people of Tawheed. And it is with conditions, with two conditions. First, that should be they should be the people of Tawheed. Allah is pleased with their actions because they are people of Tawheed. The second is to give permission to the Shafi', to the intercessor. And this permission is on the Day of Judgment. It's not before the Day of Judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the first intercessor. He says, "Ana awwalu shafi'." And this will be the great shafa'ah on the Day of Judgment when he intercedes for all mankind so that Allah relieve them from the horrors of waiting in that long day. And the Prophet ﷺ will make his shafa'ah only after permission. He says, I go and prostrate under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I praise Allah with praises that He will inspire me at that time. Until I am told, O Muhammad, raise your head. Ask and you will be given. Intercede and your intercession will be accepted. Then he will raise his head and he will make his first shafa'ah, the greatest shafa'ah. And other shafa'ahs for the Prophet ﷺ is the shafa'ah for the sinners. He says, a limit would be set for me, فَيُحَدُّ لِي حَدًّا فَأَشْفَعُ فِيهِ. A limit would be set for me, and within that limit, I will intercede. ثُمَّ يُحَدُّ لِي حَدًّا. Then another limit will be set for me, and within that limit, I will intercede. So all the shafa'ah is for Allah. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not going to intercede for anyone, just like that, so who else can claim that he will do this? Because all the shafa'ah is for Allah, you see. And those grave worshippers now, they want the Prophet to intercede for them now. They go and tell him, intercede for us. Or they tell him, make dua for us. This is the same as telling him, intercede for us. To tell him, make dua for us. Because in language, in the Arabic language, shafa'a and dua could mean the same thing. Just like salat and dua could mean the same thing. Shafa'a and dua also could mean the same thing. So if you say, O Messenger of Allah, intercede for me, this is great shirk. Because this is the right of Allah. And the Prophet will not intercede until the Day of Judgment. And after permission. So you want it now and without permission. MashaAllah. How is that? So this is great shirk. To ask the Prophet ﷺ for this shafa'ah. If we say this is great shirk, they say you deny the shafa'ah. You see? You either agree with them on the shirki shafa'ah, or you are a denier of shafa'ah. We tell them, that's your understanding. What can we do? We cannot help you. We told you. We approve several shafa'ahs for the Prophet ﷺ, but on the Day of Judgment, not now. Now, those who ask the Messenger to make dua, they not only believe that the Messenger hear them, because this is an innovation at the most, you see, but they believe that he can respond. And this is a clear denial of the saying of Allah, وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَا اسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ. If they were to hear, they would not respond. So you claim that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam hears you. That should not make you call upon him, because hearing is not enough. Can he respond? You see? And that's all they do. The Quburis, the grave worshippers, that's how they want to mislead people. يعني they take them halfway through something, you know, like this, you know. Actually, no one would call upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if he firmly believes that he cannot respond. We say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is alive, but not the life that was before death. Otherwise, why did we bury him? If it was that life, how could the companions put dust on him? As Fatima radiallahu anha was saying, when she felt very emotional, she said, how could yourselves allow you to put dust on the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know? Because she was very emotional, his daughter, you know. So, the companions, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was alive like that, they would go and ask him, especially in the fitnas that happened later on, instead of fighting and killing thousands, they could go and ask him and tell him what to do. But no. Also, Umar radiallahu anhu, after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, O Allah, when the Prophet was alive, we would come to him and make tawassul, asking him to make dua. Now he is dead, we are going to make tawassul with someone who is alive, Al-Abbas. Come on, Al-Abbas, and make dua for us. They didn't go to the Prophet. So the Prophet is alive. He is in the best life. If the martyrs enjoy a great life. But this is barzakh life. This is a different life than the dunya. That's why it's called barzakh. Because it's not dunya, not the hereafter. It's barzakh between them. So it's a special life. The faithful souls will be hanged on trees in Jannah. The martyrs, souls will be installed in birds and they will be flying in Jannah. Okay? The Prophet's souls, Allahu A'lam. Allahu A'lam. But that's the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمْ انْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. When the son of Adam dies, then all his actions are terminated except from three, and he mentioned عِلْمُ النَّافِعُ وَصَدَقَ جَارِيَةً وَوَلَدُ صَالِحِ يَدْعُو لَهُ. You see? So, the actions will be terminated. Your hearing is an action. Your seeing is an action. Your response is an action. All this is terminated. You see? Otherwise, what's the meaning of death? Yani, if you say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as those grave worshippers say, that he is alive and he that's why they make on his birthday, as they say, they sit, and then suddenly one of them gets up. He said, the Prophet has come now. Because they believe that the Prophet can come and mix with you, and they say salam to him like this, you know. Of course, no one. They fool themselves. And by this, they are fooling others, you know. So actually, we believe in the life after death, but this is a special life, you know. The life with this, with respect to dunya, has been terminated. No hearing, no seeing, no action, nothing. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna lillahi fil ard malaika sayyahin yuballighuni an ummati as-salam." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has assigned special angels to deliver salam to me from my nation. If he was hearing, why is the need for this? There is no need. That's why he says in the other hadith, مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ يُسَلِّمُ عَلَيَّ إِلَّا رَدَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ رُوحِي لِأَرُدَّ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. That when someone says salam to me, Allah will install back my soul so that I can say salam back to him. You see? Now, when someone is put in the grave, the soul is returned to him for the duration when the angels ask him, who is your Lord, who is your Prophet, who is... This duration, his soul is put back to him in a way that we don't know. And if you open the grave, you don't see him speaking or alive. It's a special way, we don't know, it's ghaib, you see. But Allah will install his soul and he can feel and hear the slippers of your shoes when you are leaving the janazah, when you are leaving him. Only that time. Only that time. After that, his soul will be taken up. That's it. Now. So hearing of the dead is a controversial issue. It's not an issue that is agreed upon by Ahl-Sunnah. It's controversial amongst Ahl-Sunnah. But what's after hearing is the problem. Now.